Good evening and welcome to another episode of History on Your Doorstep here on Bro Radio, the programme in which we investigate places and people historic to the Vale of Glamorgan. Today we are going to be focusing on Fonmon Castle, something of a hidden gem in the county. I'm delighted to be joined by Sir Brooke Boothby, who, probably got more than a slight inside knowledge of what the castle's like. So we're going to be looking at the earlier days of the castle, then we're going to be looking at some absolutely fascinating people who lived there round about the 16th century, and then we're going to be moving into Sir Brooke's own experience, really, of living there, growing up there, and the people who came and went. But if I could ask you first of all about the very earliest days of the castle, when it was built. I mean, as far as you're aware, when did the castle first come into existence?
We don't know for absolutely certain, but 1170 is pretty much the accepted date. This is because it was built by a family called Saint Jean, Norman Knights, and they were based in Basing, now Basingstoke, and they were big boys. They had 60 manors or something.
Wow.
For some reason, they were trading with Ireland,
okay. And
a son was born in Pembroke in around 1170. And it is believed that the castle was bought as a knight's fee, it was called, for the second son.
Oh.
Then what happened was, at some point, one of the boys dies, and so the other one gets the lot.
Right.
So Fonmon wasn't, or interestingly, we always call it Fonmon. But once we started open to the public, this was impossibly difficult. So it's become Fonmon. But anyway, I mean, it's London. It used to be Fonmon. And so eventually the St. John's gave up Basing and Fonmon became their headquarters.
Right.
And that went on for really quite a long time. But what's called the estate, the land, got divided in about 14-something
right. Between
two brothers.
Uh-huh.
One went to live at Highlight, not the Highlight you know in Barry,
right. But
Highlight in Wenvoe.
Oh, okay.
And they divided the land, and extraordinarily, the division point was very close to the east of the castle. It's now right by the airport.
Oh, right.
And so all the land to the west, which came at one point right down to here, to Boverton,
because
they married into the Seyes family, the Joneses, my ancestors, married the Seyes family of Boverton.
Uh-huh.
So at one point all the western lands belonged to the castle, mm-hmm. and all the eastern lands, which included Barry, were to the other junior family.
Right. And at that point, were both wings of the family still St. John's?
Yes,
right.
The Highlight lot ran out of boys eventually.
Yeah.
And there were, I think, two, if not three, inheritances via girls. And it devolved to a family called Chemist Tint.
Right.
And Tint is as in Tintsfield.
Yes.
So on and so forth. So they gradually sold off bits and whatever, and that part of it ceased to be a solid estate.
Right, okay.
But the St. John's hung on to their part, and then one of their widows became grandmother to Henry VII.
Wow.
So that pushed them up in a bit, because of course her children by Mr. St. John,
mm-hmm.
Were second cousins to Henry VIII, therefore, or third cousins, I can't remember. Anyway, they all got titles.
Yeah, yeah.
And the St. John's moved to a place called Bledsoe in, I think it's Hertfordshire,
right. Which
was the big place near London from which the power could be. But they still kept Fonmon, and there's been an interesting book written recently. I think it's called The Lady in the Tower.
Oh, right.
And it's to do with the fact that the governor of the Tower of London
at
the time was a St. John from Fonmon.
Yeah, well, they crop up a lot. I find them. Their name creeps through all sorts of different bits of research.
If you do major research on the St. John's, you find that over the centuries, because they're still going,
yeah.
They have held something like one dukedom, 12 earldoms, more lordships than you care to think about, and so on and so forth. They've come and gone, but but they were there.
Yeah, I mean, like all historic buildings, obviously it didn't all shoot up in one go. It's obviously developed in stages. Architecturally, what is there now that would have been contemporary with the earlier days? I mean, the keep, I guess, is the oldest part.
It's a rectangular block in the centre.
Right.
Which they, Ancient Monuments Commission.
Yeah.
Have said might be the original 1170,
right.
But they said because of the way it was purchased, it might be that they built a wooden fort first,
right,
and then, say, in 12-something, built the stone fort.
Yes.
And we don't know what the answer to that one is, because they bought Fonmon off the Umfraville family of Penmark.
Yes.
They were serious Norman lords. They'd come in 1090 with Fitzhamon into South Wales, which was the first Norman incursion. And of course, history or families love to promote their own history. So my history when I grew up was that, of course, the St. John's were one of the 12 knights that had come with Fitzhamon. That's been debunked pretty solidly.
Yes, I was going to come to that.
Yeah, exactly. And it's exactly the same with the next crew, the Joneses, my ancestor. Colonel Philip Jones had a family tree made, you know, a scroll.
Yeah.
Top two lines, Ap Adam, Ap Theo. So we know exactly where we come from.
Yes.
God, Adam, and King David's in there. But then it goes a bit astray. King Pellinore's in there. Yeah. Arthur's not, because, of course, Arthur never had legitimate children.
Well, there was a lot of mist thrown up by Sir Edward Stradling with his the taking of lands from Welshmen's hands. And I know in his own family, for example, were listed amongst the 12 knights, but there's no evidence of them having been anywhere in the area for 200 years. The Joneses are, for me, a wonderful topic, and I'd like to talk to them a bit more.
Possibly my favourite character from the castle's history. A fascinating chap who grew to be arguably one of the most powerful people in the nation, but for whatever reason doesn't seem to be anything like as well known as he should be. A chap who originated from Swansea called Colonel Philip Jones. Now, he bought the castle during one of the most turbulent times in British history, certainly one of the great levellers, during the Civil War. And he bought the castle from a family who were on the same side as him. They were Presbyterians. They were naturally aligned towards the parliamentarians. So the transaction wasn't anything that was enforced. There wasn't any skullduggery going on. But it was the family, the St. John's, we were talking about a moment ago, who it appeared may have fallen on some hard times and were selling off estates left, right and centre. But because it was a war, as we were just discussing during the break, paperwork maybe not the best. We don't have a lot of records of what went on, but we do know quite a lot about Colonel Philip simply because of the extraordinary things he achieved. What do you know about him? What's your recollections?
It's very difficult to separate myth from reality.
As always,
we have almost certainly been able to trace his branch of the Joneses back to Machynlleth. But again, in his family trees that he did, because he not only did one in English, but he also did one in Welsh, which took him, of course, back to Rodri Mawr and Blenheim ap Maenach and so on and so forth, to make himself a senior Welshman as well as a senior Englishman. But Colonel Philip himself was clearly an immensely able man.
Yeah.
He rose under Cromwell, finished up as godfather to Richard Cromwell. He was controller of Cromwell's household. And it was before the days of, what's the parliamentary record called now?
Hansard. Yeah.
Before the days of Hansard. But one of the MPs got up and said, we cannot longer have this country run from a small castle in Wales. Because Cromwell was ill.
Yeah.
Richard Cromwell, frankly, wasn't up to it. And so unless you could get past Colonel Philip, you couldn't get either of them.
Yeah.
And so essentially, he every time he didn't want something to happen, he retired to Fonmon. And well, that was it.
Yeah. You know. Well, quite famously, retired to Fonmon when the death warrant was due to be signed for Charles I, and he was conveniently in Wales, quote unquote.
Yeah. Absent upon his Welsh estates, he was listed as being a very good place to be, particularly when the king's son gets back on the throne.
Well, as it was to turn out, his rise to fortune was absolutely vast. Some figures that I managed to dig up, I mean, obviously these were estimates, so we don't know how much we can put behind this. But it was estimated in the year 1640, his income was £20 a year. By the year 1658, so only 18 years later, it was £2,000 a year. And given the period of history we are talking about, that is a phenomenal rise in terms of income. Remarkable. And I suppose because of the period, a lot of the stalwart families, like the Stradlings, for example, that would undoubtedly in their day have outranked him, were on the wrong side. So when it came to responsibility being handed out, people like himself and Bussy Mansell, another famous parliamentarian, yep, did awfully well when it came to taking on power, taking on titles, and being the representatives of Cromwell in Wales.
And over the next couple of generations, of course, they very cleverly married each other.
Yeah.
The Edwins of Langhangel and all that lot, they married into our lot, and so did the Dunravens,
yes,
and so on and so, but not the Stradlings, interestingly enough. Far as I know, we have no Stradling connection, even to the 14th cousin or something.
Yeah, because you were on completely different sides, being Protestants and Catholics during the Reformation, and then Parliamentarians and Monarchists during the Civil War. You know, the two great levelers of history.
Yeah.
And your two families were on completely opposing sides. So I suppose it's that surprising that they weren't that.
Well, for me, I've had to live with it because, of course, the Boothby side were royalists through and through.
Yeah, yeah.
And
hence, I mean, this is one of the most wonderful contradictions, I think. The portrait at the foot of the stairs with Cromwell on one side and King Charles on the other side.
Yes, we used to be, I thought, a little more tactful. We had Colonel Philip there,
yeah,
and then we had Cromwell there in a left-hand corner.
Yeah.
And Charles was up on the gallery.
Oh, I see.
Charles and Cromwell could not see each other. And neither of them, no, well, they could see Colonel Philip. They could both see Colonel Philip, but neither could see each other.
Yeah.
That was how
they look like Colonel Philip is keeping them apart currently, which is probably not a bad analogy. And of course, he named his son Oliver as well. So, I mean, he knew how to play the game.
Oh, absolutely. And the name Oliver came right down to the last Jones at Fonmon.
Is that right?
Yeah, Oliver Henry Jones, who died in 1917.
Wow.
They kept Robert and Oliver were the two big names in the family.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, there's lots. I've come across lots and lots of Roberts.
Yeah, there was Robert the First, Robert the Second, Robert the Third, Robert the Fourth, and then Robert Oliver.
Yeah. So I alluded to what happened next. I mean, there's quite an interesting story. I mean, bearing in mind that we just said that from a Protestant family, here's somebody who potentially was Jacobite, but who in later life actually introduced Methodism to the family, as it was he who had his head turned by the innkeeper's daughter. Is that right?
Quite possibly.
So as I understand,
I mean, the Wesleys were very good friends.
Yeah.
There's no question of that. I mean, you've just got to look at the letters from Charles and John.
Yeah.
To say, but they were particularly friendly with Mrs. Jones.
Yes, and it's Mrs. Jones I was thinking of. Wasn't she from the connected with the Blue Anchor in some way? Is that
well,
right?
I think originally she came from across the water.
Oh, right, okay.
But in those days, you imagine the problem of getting from Somerset right around by Gloucester and back down here again. I mean, the old road's nightmare.
Yeah.
So everything went by boat.
Absolutely.
And, of course, Aberthaw was the port, and so Aberthaw, I think her family came from near Minehead.
Ah. Well, that was a regular passage,
yeah,
Aberthaw to Minehead.
But don't... You might want to check that.
Okay, just in case. But was she the Did she actually live at the Blue Anchor, or was she just staying there?
No, she lived at the Fontenagary, what is now the Fontenagary Inn.
Oh, I see.
Because that was the dower house. She didn't get on with her son, Robert III, at all.
Right, yes.
She considered Wild Robert. Wild Robert considered him to be a playboy and except that she wasn't quite as Puritan as we might think.
Okay.
Because when we were altering the Fontenagary Inn to put in new public toilets,
yeah,
we dug up a bunch of old wine bottles from exactly that her period there.
Oh, right.
And they've even got her initials on.
No.
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Which is very unusual because, yeah, I mean, you may be aware that in those days it wasn't the wine that was in them, the bottle was the valuable bit.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody had, I mean, the ones which say RJ or R Fonmon Castle, J Fonmon Castle, we got lots. But hers actually were in her own name, which must mean that she was prepared to offer alcoholic refreshment even though she was a staunch Methodist.
Well, well, well.
Which is quite interesting.
Yes, it is, absolutely. But then there's all sorts of... In the early days of Methodism, there was an awful lot of... I did some research on another project. I found pubs that had Methodist schools in back rooms. So
yes.
I think those lines were blurred early on, and they early just became on. A little bit more
yes,
staunch.
I think that's exactly correct.
Yeah.
Because the very first school in the Fonmon Rousse area was in what are now the two lodges as you come to the gate.
Right.
That was the very first school.
Oh, right, okay. And was that a Methodist faith school? Was it that?
I wouldn't like to say. Because it went right on into the 19th century until, you know, the school acts, education acts went through, and then there was Rousse School and it ceased to be. It came back into the family as a house.
Right, right. Okay. Fantastic. I mean, I find the whole legacy of the Joneses is absolutely fascinating. One of the other things that we just touched on briefly, but I'd just like to go back to because I think it's fantastic, is how it was that Colonel Philip managed to survive the Restoration. And the story of how his enemies, because you can't get to be that powerful without making enemies along the way, how they tried to do him in and what they tried to fit him up with. Because it is quite extraordinary.
The great trick is that, to my mind, and this is my conjecture, is that he saw off the two big ones.
Yeah.
The big ones clearly is that he was a cabinet minister when they executed King Charles, and he got out of that.
Yeah.
And the other one was some people accused him of stealing the pay of the army in Ireland.
Yes.
And he simply said, look, it was handed to my custody, this huge amount of loot, to pay the army in Ireland in Gloucester.
Yeah.
I had to get it through quite large areas of anti-parliamentarian.
Yeah.
So I had to hire companies of troops and pay them well to get it through. So that's where the money went. So he got out of that one.
Yeah.
So after that, all the accusations were, well, you mentioned some right at the beginning.
Yeah. Well, some of them are quite amusing. But yeah, a couple of quotes I came across give an idea of how powerful he was. In 1658, one quotes, Richard Cromwell will only take advice from Jones and Thurlow and would do nothing without them.
That's exactly correct. So, that's what the correspondence in the family
incredible
attests.
Yeah, yeah, but Thurlow also survived. He was also initially charged with treason, but went on to become a foreign minister for the.
Well, I think the other thing that Charles II and his senior advisers had to take into account, was that if Thurlow and Jones had really backed Richard Cromwell, there could have been another civil war.
Yeah.
And in the end, they didn't, I don't know the details of how Richard Cromwell was agreed to step down and etc., and how they persuaded other senior parliamentarians to accept the king. But the fact is that those two made a big contribution to a peaceful restoration.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think that was appreciated.
It was, without a shadow of a doubt. We mentioned earlier the third Robert Jones, who had the nickname Wild Robert, brought up in a household. His father died when he was very young. Is that right?
Precisely,
4 years old or something?
Yes, he was brought up by his mother.
And?
Well, she tried to... He was pretty rebellious.
Yeah.
And the Wesleys recommended he should be whipped through Harrow if he didn't behave better. But he never did. And the crucial thing is, and I mentioned earlier on that these new families consolidated themselves by marrying.
Yeah.
And he married the Seyes of Boverton.
Yes.
Only daughter, heiress.
Right.
Then she dies without having a child.
Oh.
And her father sues him in the High Court to get the Boverton estates back, but loses, because in those days, on marriage, the estates moved.
Yeah.
So at that point, he's got loads of money because he flogs them all.
Right.
And that is why Fonmon looks like he did. From around 1760,
yeah,
he... I mean, Simon Jenkins, when he was doing his book on things,
yeah,
he did say Fonmon is unique in this respect. Here you've got a 12th century castle,
yeah,
and smack in the middle of it is an 18th century Rococo library.
Yeah.
And they just don't exist anywhere else.
No, no. I mean, it is a stunning.
And you can walk halfway up those stairs, you can walk in the hall. There you are in the hall with all the paintings and everything. You walk one door through,
yeah,
and you've got bare stone and you know, the guard robes, the toilets as they were. Toilets, incidentally, were always on the southeast.
Okay.
Because the bulk of the wind came from the northwest.
Sensible.
So they, therefore, the wind took them away. So anyway, so Robert, yes, and he ran off onto the continent and got himself into various trouble and eventually went more or less bust.
Yeah, he would make a great novel. I mean, he's such a character. I mean, and his legacy, what he's left. I mean, is the ceiling down to him in the
library?
Right.
The interesting thing in that library, there is a 17th century ceiling above that one.
Oh, right.
But all its centre has been cut out, and you've just got the edges left all the way around.
Wow.
So the room was higher originally.
Good grief.
Yeah. And that arch in the middle of the library holds 84 tons of masonry on the top of it. And slowly, after 200 years, it was going like this.
Right.
And my father poo-pooed it and said no, until eventually a structural engineer appeared and flatly refused to sit underneath it. He said this could come down at any time. And at that point, my father bit the bullet, and it's now all steel RSJs behind it.
Good.
But huge problems, because we had to cut the... they're called spandrels of plasterwork out, because they're really good.
Good Lord.
They had to be cut out, put to one side, then the whole thing rebuilt, and then put back again.
Wow. Well, then,
it took 2.5 years, I think.
Good grief.
It was a huge blubber.
Well, you'd never know to look at it now. No. It's a staggering job. I mean, that's a marvellous bit of a...
And then, from then on, it was very interesting, because the next... three generations of Joneses, Robert IV, Robert Oliver, and Oliver Henry, all inserted themselves into the rising industrial power of South Wales.
Right.
You know, they were senior magistrates, and they were this and that and the other.
Mm-hmm.
But they never again, after the time of Robert II, tried to act on the national
stage. Had their fingers burned, so to speak.
Possibly.
Yeah.
Possibly.
Yeah.
Well, and let's be honest, though, South Wales was the burgeoning point of the entire planet at that moment.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you've got your nicely in.
Yeah. Well, it didn't. There's lots of families that did awfully well. Well, of course, there were the Wyndham Quins from Dunraven, we were mentioning a moment ago. I mean, they did awfully well.
So, that was then. And eventually, Oliver Henry Jones had no children.
Yeah.
And then there was a really rather awkward matter, because somehow his wife got it into her head that it was going to be left to her brother.
Oh.
And instead of which, he left it to his sister's daughters.
Okay.
My grandmother. And the other one didn't marry.
Right.
So, effectively, to my grandmother. And, of course, that caused, when he died, it caused the most incredible upheaval.
I can imagine.
Because this poor widow, and I do feel a bit sorry for her. I mean, my side of the family tend to say she was a nasty bit of work, because she took everything she possibly could. But
That's families.
I suspect she was quite domineering, and he just said, yes, yes, darling, I'll leave it to your brother to keep her quiet. And then when the will was read, bingo, it wasn't there.
Yeah, well, of course, once you're gone, that's the time to tell bad news to somebody like that, isn't it? You're not there to see the repercussions.
Exactly so. So that was the end of the Joneses. But he did try to find a possible Jones heir all over the world. He instructed lawyers.
Oh, right.
And I have received visits from one from Kentucky, who said, oh yes, my grandfather was offered this castle by Oliver Henry, but didn't want to move from America. Another lot came from South Africa, another lot came from Australia.
Good Lord.
And they'd all recorded it in their family histories that they'd been offered the castle.
Wow, I'm not surprised really.
But none of them wanted it.
Wow.
Because he was falling down.
Yeah, oh I see, that old chestnut. Well, this kind of brings us to you and your immediate family. I mean, what do you recall living in the castle, people who visited, things that happened that you remember?
Well, primarily for me, it was initially quite a lonely operation because I had two sisters, but they were 8 and 10 years older than me. So they were off at boarding school by the time I can actually remember anything. Mm-hmm. So it was just me and there was a nanny. And I didn't see much of my parents.
Right.
I was taken to visit them once a week on Sundays. Mm-hmm. And one day, it was always after lunch, and one day Nanny came back later to find both my parents had fallen asleep. Obviously it was a good Sunday lunch. And I was in the grate playing with the coals and the fire, which was lit. And there was me playing around. And she completely lost her temper and told my mother that if she couldn't even stay awake for an hour or two to see her son and heir, then Nanny was going to leave and an awful lot of grovelling had to be done. And there's another lovely story about that, because my nanny came from Lady Plymouth at St. Fagans.
Fagans, yes.
And she was a junior there and then was promoted to be the lead nanny at Fonmon. And but my mother had been told, this was now just, I was born in 49, so it was just after the war. Old nannies in those days never had a day off. They moved into the big houses, my mother's house at Pencline Castle. Her old nanny was still there when she died.
I mean,
she never went anywhere, never did anything. But my mother was told that in this modern world post-war, Nanny ought to have a day off per week.
Wow.
So she summons Nanny. Glynis, I'm told you are to have a day off a week. Well, that would be kind. Thank you, milady. Very good. Which day would you want? And some discussion on Thursday or whatever. Right. Very well. That's agreed. You will, of course, take the boy with you. But for me, this was one of the greatest joys of my childhood.
Yeah.
Because my nanny's was one of 9 children.
Right.
Her parents by then, all their children had grown up.
Yeah.
And they absolutely adored having this little boy in their garden. And I used to do vegetables with the father and cooking with the mother and everything. And I had a wonderful time. Nanny would go off with her friends to the cinema or whatever, and I'd stay with her parents and have a ball.
Fantastic.
But I love the idea. But of course you will take the boy with you.
Oh, remarkable. And of course, since adulthood, I mean, your responsibilities as the Vice Lord Lieutenant of the county, I mean, that's taken you into all sorts of different places and all sorts of different roles. I mean, how has that played out?
Well, my father was one or other of the family has been Lord Lieutenant, Vice Lieutenant, Lieutenant and Deputy Lieutenant throughout the Queen's reign.
Okay.
And I was very sorry to be ill recently and not to get to the St. Paul's service, because my father went to the coronation and the silver and I went to the gold and the diamond, but couldn't make it to the platinum. But therefore there is a continuity of service in the family. And that hasn't really changed that much. It's a very good system in a way, in that the Queen chooses her Lord Lieutenant, but both the Prince of Wales and the First Minister of Wales have a input. And so that's a sensible way of doing it nowadays, to make sure, because you don't want a Lord Lieutenant of this area, which includes Cardiff. You've got, you don't want a Lord Lieutenant, Queen's representative in the capital city, the First Minister doesn't like him. That's not a good idea. And Morvan Meredith, who is our present Lord Lieutenant, suits extremely well into that pocket. Because the Boothby family, you see, are much older than the Joneses. We reputedly turned up in Lincolnshire, were Danes, in 842. Why are we so accurate?
That is 842. Very precise.
And we've, I mean, of course, it's just what some of, there was a historian called Camden who used to write dates when he didn't know them, he just put them in. So Camden, in about 1600, says that we came in 842, so we've just accepted that. And then the Boothbys have meandered about the country in various places and were quite good at inheriting estates.
Very good. It's a good thing to be good at.
Well, yes and no. You know, that castle, until we sold it, was a huge burden. Because it had never been maintained during the period of the last Jones widow. And then the war came. Well, the 30s slump, then the war, and it just, I mean, my father was faced with 70 years of back repairs, and he did what he could, and I took over and did a whole shedload more, but we never caught up.
No,
and Nigel's still busily out.
No, I heard the first thing he did when he moved in was put a new roof on the Cosmillion, so it's a never-ending, you're a custodian at best, isn't it?
Yeah, we've done about two-fifths of the roof, but he's done the big chunks, the three-fifths. Yeah,
absolutely fantastic. Sir Brooke Boothby, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you today about Fonmon Castle. Thank you so much for joining me.